Up next on Insider's Roundtable, we continue our look at positive changes in healthcare in the Yakima Valley.
Insider's Roundtable, underwritten by TreeTop and by Thorner, Kennedy, and Gano, and by the Yakima Herald Republic.
Good evening and welcome to Insider's Roundtable. I'm Heidi O'Malley. Last month, we began a three-part look at healthcare issues in the Yakima Valley and how some various entities are proactively looking to resolve some issues that have created the need for healthcare reform in the first place. We looked at the overuse of area emergency departments and improving general access to healthcare last time. This time, we want to focus on collaboration and communication and how improving those areas of the system will go a long ways to reduce costs and improve overall outcomes. We are joined tonight by Dr. Rich Spiegel, President of Signal Health, and Dr. Jeff Kaplan, Medical Director of Memorial Physicians, and we thank you both for joining us. Let's talk about collaboration and what that means. Sometimes a patient maybe with a chronic medical conditions may see one doctor and then a specialist in one area of their health and then maybe a third doctor, and sometimes the communication between the doctors doesn't quite go across the board. Is that what we're talking about when we talk about collaboration?
Medical care is fragmented in the Yakima area. Physicians practice in small independent offices for the most part. And when a patient does see multiple doctors, there does have to be communication, and it's not always the best communication. We have electronic health records that don't talk to each other. Sometimes appropriate records are sent between physicians and sometimes not. And so it can be a problem.
Dr. Kaplan, your background, you've been a family doc for 20-some years in the Yakima Valley. Do you see that from time to time?
Absolutely. I think that care is highly fragmented, which means people are not communicating well. If they are communicating, they're not necessarily reading it or updating the record, so somebody who doesn't know the patient can know exactly what's been going on.
Mm-hmm. We've come a long ways from the family doc in the rural communities where everybody just had one doctor. Do doctors understand the value of collaboration? It's not that they don't get it, that this is important.
Oh, absolutely. Physicians are very busy. They have a lot to do every day, and they do want to communicate with each other, but sometimes it doesn't happen. You ask that something be done and it doesn't get done, or you intend to, but it doesn't get done because it is time-consuming, because it is not streamlined. And so, unfortunately, communication does fall through the cracks at times.
There's a push here driving towards clinical integration. Can you explain what clinical integration is?
Simply, it's the different healthcare providers working together, not just looking at their own piece of the healthcare pie, looking at their own part of an individual patient's care, but thinking about what they're doing and how it affects what others are doing, and trying to bring those pieces together so that we are doing the best we can for a patient.
And in the case of here locally, what you're looking at is an organization called Signal Health. And it is based on a Chicago effort.
That's right.
And can you tell me exactly what they have found in Chicago, what has been working for them?
Sure. The group in Chicago is called Advocate Physician Partners. It's nearly 4,000 physicians now, most of whom don't know each other. They're spread throughout the Chicago area, urban and suburban, wealthy to poor. And they've been put together in a virtual network where they've agreed to be measured on certain quality metrics and work together to standardize care, to reduce the waste in the healthcare system. So their big goals are to improve the quality of the care they provide, to improve access to care for patients, to improve patient satisfaction, and at the same time to lower the overall costs by coordinating the care and reducing waste.
And I'm sure you bought onto this concept and are in favor of it. What about what they're doing in Chicago has impressed you?
I've been less involved with that part, but I think they're focused on the key points. And I think Rich identified many of them. Improving quality based upon agreed upon definitions of quality, and so trying to work on that. Standardizing care so that you narrow variability, how different providers practice. right now there's a very wide spectrum about how people practice for the very same problem. You want best practices to be used. Enhancing patient safety. We cause enormous problems to patient safety in our current systems, and they're working on trying to improve patient safety so that care for patients as well as employees are all better.
Give me an example of that.
Of patient safety?
Yes.
Well, I think if you looked at, in the general, the Institute of Medicine report back in 1999 looked at this in a report called To Err Is Human. And they identify that the healthcare system in hospitals in this country is probably causing 44 to 99,000 people to die unexpectedly in hospitals per year in this country. That's not an acceptable number. It's actually about 1 in 1,000 people who go into a hospital that can happen. If you look at the airline industry, they've lowered their unexpected loss to 1 in 10 million. We should be working and are working, the hospital's working, and individuals are working to change this. What you want is a real systems approach across the system, making it hard to make an error as opposed to it being based upon one individual's decision. So you adopt processes like the Swiss cheese process, where you make sure the holes don't line up, and you make sure you put barriers in place that make it easy to do the right thing and hard to make an error.
Mm-hmm. How does patient outreach play into this process? That, you know, that's a part of the Chicago philosophy. How important is it to you?
Well, we have to engage patients in their own care. Mm-hmm. So if that's what you're referring
right.
to, that's a very important part. And I'm going to let Jeff talk about that a lot more because he is a primary care physician. But this is only going to work if patients are involved in their own care, if they understand what's being asked of them, if they agree, if they're given the options and mm-hmm. they can have their input and say, this works best for me at this stage of my life. But then they have to come to appointments, they have to take medicines, they have to let us know if they're having problems with medicine so we can work around that. They have to work on lifestyle changes that can benefit their own health. So it's not just a one-sided thing. Have the doctor do what he or she needs to do. It's a partnership between the doctor and the patient.
Are there times, though, when the patients maybe cannot be their own case manager and you need another person involved? And is there a gap in having enough case managers, if you will, for patients like that?
Well, there are certainly cases where patients do not serve very well as their own best advocate mm-hmm. and have trouble engaging in it. I think the case manager issue is one that we've had a lot of discussions on in terms of would it be helpful to have somebody or those individuals in the community who can help facilitate the care for those individuals. I think we've agreed it looks like a really good project. It's something we're interested in. At this point, we haven't found great data that it saves money. But there are certainly reports across the country where this can actually improve care for those patients who are at highest risk or who are getting readmitted frequently for circumstances that may not be necessary. It's, I think what Rich is facing and really looking at is how do we design a program that we can show cost effectiveness as well. And will something like that really pan out and be able to do so? And I think that's a challenge we're all looking at and trying to face.
Right. And something that they've been able to do in Chicago, which it's taken about 7 years, but they've now been able to enter into what they called a shared savings contract with Blue
mm-hmm.
Shield.
That's right.
And is that the goal eventually, to move from a pay-for-service to pay-for, is it prevention?
Performance.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about that, the switch from pay-for-service to pay-for-performance.
Okay, so in the Yakima area, we're in an almost exclusively fee-for-service world. So we get paid a certain amount for everything we do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like piecework.
Sure.
If we get to do this much, if you do more of it, then you make more money.
Mm-hmm.
And so that leads you to one type of behavior. The big move in the United States, and it's certainly happened in other areas of the United States more than in Yakima, is to move to pay for performance or pay for quality, where you're getting paid to keep people healthier, mm-hmm. to actually do less, to keep them out of the hospital. Mm-hmm. And the way you act when you're paid for performance or quality is totally different than the way you act in a fee-for-service world. And the real trick is staying financially successful so that you're still here to provide care as you move from one to the other. So one of the purposes of Signal Health is to allow us to be in both those worlds simultaneously as we make the transition, rather than having this sudden change that it's hard to adapt to. So we're working with some of the major commercial insurance companies who are very interested in making that switch as well, to see how we can make that transition.
Right. Have you had any instances where you have shifted to pay for performance? Is that something you're working towards?
I think we're working towards it in collaboration with Signal Health. Mm-hmm. We've not been doing it individually since all these programs are being set up at the same time.
What do you see as maybe one of the biggest hurdles in doing that? What is the hardest thing to break through when you're switching? That seems like quite a radical shift in way of doing things.
When you're shifting from a fee-for-service to pay-for-performance?
Right.
Well, I think I would probably say you and I would agree it's crossing this chasm between having to make the changes in your system when you're not getting paid for it. Mm-hmm. And these changes are capital intensive and people intensive. And since we can't retain the money within the system on those circumstances, like such as a closed system like group health, which keeps all the money within its system, if you become far more efficient and you're not getting paid for it, then there's no money in the system to sustain the changes you're making. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a strong willingness on the part of providers to really engage in this. There's some concern, what does that mean in the near term? Can we sustain it? Mm-hmm.
There is a major risk in this shift, as Jeff just said, that the payment model is so different that you will not survive financially to get to that new world. One of the major organizations that did a pilot program with the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services to look at a shared savings program did a very good job at quality of care. They did a very good job at cost savings, and it cost them millions of dollars to put in the pieces to allow that to happen. But they got no shared savings from the Medicare program, and they were hurt financially by doing that. So even though they had done well, the program was set up in such a way that they were not able to financially benefit from that, and it was financially unsustainable. So they're doing the right thing, but that is the real trick, is to sustain organizations, hospitals and physicians, practices, so that they're still here when we switch over to the new world.
And so that is the dilemma you have.
It is.
In creating Signal Health. Now, Signal Health is open to anyone.
That's
correct?
Right. Do you want me to talk a little bit about Signal Health?
Sure.
Okay, I'm going to give credit to Rick Linaway, the CEO of Memorial Hospital, for getting this whole thing started in early 2010. And I went through a process where there was a steering committee with a dozen doctors and a few administrators who looked at data locally to see if we had the pieces in place that we could build on to put together a network of physicians. And the decision was made in late 2010 to do that. And the work really, a lot of groundwork was done for the next several months, but the work really started about a year ago. And it's taken a tremendous amount of infrastructure to get the pieces in place. We've had a physician and administrator group called the Operating Committee that's worked for the past year and 3 months to put the pieces in place. So our aim is to be open to all physicians, nurse practitioners, and physician assistants, as well as other healthcare providers in the Yakima area, and eventually in our whole referral area, to come together in this same type of network that Advocate put together 10 years ago, and to coordinate the care, as we've talked about earlier. We will look at how doctors are performing on various quality metrics, they're called. So we know there are certain things we should be doing for patients with diabetes to keep them healthy. The same thing for coronary disease, various disease states. And there's lots of research that shows there are some specific things we should be doing every time. And even though that's our intention to do it every time, it's not happening right now. So having the quality metrics there, having Signal Health collecting data to look at that, reporting that back to physicians, they can see those patients in whom they have not done all the measures that we all agree are important. And so it's a reminder. It's like a checklist system for a pilot before taking off. So that's one area that we're working on. The real savings, and it's important for us as physicians and hospitals to save money, because it's the cost of healthcare is unsustainable. Right. It's gotten past the point where a lot of people couldn't even afford to have health insurance or have health care. Mm-hmm. And that's not right. And we are in the best position to find the most savings that we can to provide even better quality of care than we do now, but at a lower cost, so it is sustainable. So in addition to those specific quality metrics, like did you measure a certain type of cholesterol, the bad right. cholesterol, did you control it, did you measure the blood pressure, did you control it, we also need to look at systems issues where physicians work together and physicians work with hospitals to say, what are all the pieces that are involved in the care of a patient from the beginning of an episode of illness to the end, or if they have a chronic disease, ongoing, and say, how can we do this in a more standardized way so it's research-based and so we are eliminating tests that aren't critical for that patient? We don't want to take away things that are necessary, right. but there are things that are done, duplicate tests that really didn't advance the health of that patient, mm-hmm. and we need to eliminate those. So we need to see how we can provide that whole spectrum of care for that patient in the most cost-effective manner and keep them the healthiest. So that is really what we're working toward, and it's a very difficult thing. We're going to have people look at right. how they do business differently.
But the good part of it is there is the 9 years or plus years that Chicago has been
that's
making
right.
it work
right.
that you can
So that's why we're modeling ourselves on advocates. So they organized themselves 10 years ago. They have had shared savings with insurance companies for the past 8 years. And they started with one insurance company who was willing to jump in and say, let's give this a try. Now they're working with 10 insurance companies, all the major insurance companies in the Chicago area. And they really have made it work. But it was a slow process. And we're trying to speed that up here in Yakima by working with Advocate mm-hmm. So that we can learn from how they did things and we can implement those at a more rapid rate. They had to make it up as they went
right.
and they had some false starts, and we're trying to avoid those
sure,
false starts
sure.
by learning from what they did.
Get going on it. Let's also kind of talk about preventative. Would Signal Health also help you to be proactive with, you know, the obesity problem in America? Would there be incentives to work with, you know, parents of children, for instance, mm-hmm. who might be following the same path of yeah. their parents as far as that issue goes?
So that's a very important point to bring up. At Signal Health, we don't want to just say, how can we best deal with patients when they're sick?
Right.
We want to say, how do we keep people healthy? So there really is a two-prong effort, mm-hmm. or there will be as we mature. One is to care for patients when they are sick in a more cost-effective, higher-quality manner. The other is population health. How do we get out in the community and help people stay healthier? Mm-hmm. Dr. Adrian Bennett, who's a hospitalist at Memorial, and I have made visits to three major businesses in the Yakima area, just introducing ourselves, saying we would like to work with you. How can we work together mm-hmm. in your workplace or overall to keep the people that you insure healthier? So these are baby steps. We're just starting,
right.
but that is our goal, is to also deal with the population health side.
Because how hard is that right now as a family doctor to address that when you're, you know, dealing with critically ill patients, you also have to deal with preventing people from getting ill.
Well, I think promoting wellness is essential to any system, and mm-hmm. it's something that's been largely neglected within our system that mm-hmm. focuses on acute care and management of exacerbations of chronic care. And I think this collaboration, therefore, goes beyond physician to physician. It includes employers. It includes engaging the patients in different ways into their own care. Mm-hmm. This can't succeed if people don't choose to really partake of it in positive ways and also wish to change some of their behaviors. You can't make the system work without their participation. And there are tools happening with electronic records and so forth mm-hmm. that now have patients involved in their care in very different ways. And the models that have been successful, I think, tend to promote strong patient engagement.
Mm-hmm.
And it means changing behavior across a whole system. It's not just one piece of the system.
Right. We spoke briefly before we started about the Affordable Health Care Act, and the thing Signal Health has going for it is it's based on a model that has been proven effective. Are there concerns about if Affordable Health Care Act goes forward, is that based on things that have worked?
Well, I think there's, you know, the Affordable Care Act has gotten some very bad press because of the mandate that everybody be covered, which is probably a whole separate issue. But there's also a bunch of other provisions in the Affordable Care Act that impact directly on quality. It actually starts to fund comparative evidence research to see what works. Right now, if a product gets approved, a physician can utilize that product in whatever way they wish, and a new product that's more expensive will tend to get marketed versus older, inexpensive products. What we don't know is what works best, because because the system doesn't mandate that be viewed. Creative studies are done to justify a certain product. So comparative evidence research is trying to answer the question, what works best? If I buy a refrigerator, I might go look at Consumer Reports and see what works best. Mm-hmm. Shouldn't we have access to the same type of tools for healthcare?
Right. It seems that, and I don't know how unique Yakima is to being proactive. I'm assuming doctors and communities across the nation are coming together in similar ways. Not waiting for somebody else to tell them how to fix their system, but they're wanting to fix their system. Is that right?
Right. When Advocates started 10 years ago, they were one of very few organizations, and they're one of really very few that showed a successful path. But now, every day, I get emails from different groups like the American College of Cardiology and other groups that show demonstration projects. People are trying different things. Literally dozens and dozens and dozens of organizations like Signal Health are springing up because we know that's the right way to go. We need to change how we're providing care. It's not because it's not sustainable. Mm-hmm. And that seems to be by far the best model out there. So it really is become quite common, but everybody's about the same stage as right. Signal Health is. So they're in the early stages, and it's going to take time to mature to get the full effect, but it's good that it started.
Good. And I think that probably the general public that's not in the medical field or community hears the news and thinks all gloom and doom about healthcare, but I think you were saying it's an exciting time to be in healthcare.
Well, I think for many of us, we've wanted to see a system that promotes wellness, that makes people healthier, that focuses on quality. And there are frustrations with a system that is extraordinarily expensive. We pay far, far more than any other country in the world and doesn't deliver the product that almost all of us would like to see delivered. And I think Rich and I share that frustration about where we've been and that hope of where we can actually make this system a much better system. And that's going to take all of us. It takes all the partners within the system, not just physicians, but whole organizations and a political will to make this system much better.
One thing that was interesting to me is before I even knew where my office was practically when I took this job, I had people coming to me from the medical community in Yakima saying, I've had this idea, I've wanted to do this, but mm-hmm. there's just been no way of doing that. And they see Signal Health as a mechanism for allowing that.
That's great. So you are optimistic this will be up and running when?
Well, we have nearly 100 doctors signed on so far. We're hoping for 150, 200. Uh-huh. It's whoever wants to join, and I've made probably 25 presentations to physicians to bring them on. Mm-hmm. And we are now negotiating with a couple of the major insurance companies to come up with a contract that will allow that transition from fee-for-service to pay-for-performance. So I hope by late this year that we will have one or two contracts in place, and we'll have a full complement of physicians and other healthcare providers. And so by 2013, I'm hoping that we will be in a position where we'll start to have some impact in the Yakima area.
That's great. And it seems like the Yakima Valley, the community works fairly well together. Would you say that they do?
Absolutely. Yeah. I don't have rose-colored
sure.
glasses, but I started practicing here in 1981, and I have always been struck by the attitude of wanting to do what's right for people here. You don't come to the Yakima Valley if your main interest is income, is money, money, money. It's to do the right thing for the right people. It's people who like being here. And I've always felt that people are open to trying things. And I have had so little pushback when I've made my presentations. It's been very refreshing. I can't see everybody's jumping up and down saying, oh boy. but they understand the concept. And then there's always skepticism when you ask for change. And I think it's healthy. But I've been quite impressed with how people are accepting that this is the way to go and they're interested in getting involved in it.
I would agree with that.
Good. It sounds like it's a positive time and an encouraging for healthcare consumers like me to know that that these issues are on the forefront of your minds and things are moving towards some success, and we wish you good luck with that.
I think there's a sense, Heidi, that there's a lot more positive things going on in healthcare than what you commonly see portrayed.
Right.
I agree.
I think frequently it's all negative, and the fact that enormous numbers of physicians are coming forward across the country wanting to change it for the better and seeing this as their opportunity, when they don't have to do that, they could live within the old system quite comfortably,
right.
Is heartening.
Great. Well, that's a great place to end it. We thank you both for coming, and we thank you for watching.
Insiders Roundtable, underwritten by TreeTop, and by Thorner, Kennedy, and Gano, and by the Yakima Herald-Republic.